Hey everybody! Welcome back to Northern Lion Plays Enter the Gungeon. We're in a bit of a weird position because I actually won last run. That's unusual for me, thank you for the kind words on that, and also some of the unkind words about how I misused the charmed horn. What have we unlocked here? The cat claw. Nothing is quite so terrifying as the skeleton found deep in the fourth chamber. Slay 30. Well, we've already slayed about 2,000, so 30 shouldn't be that much of a trial here. We did get carried on the last run, I think that much is pretty indisputable, but we also played actually really well. I got some tweets that brightened my day. Usually people are like, oh, NL makes me feel like I'm better at Gungeon than I actually am, but I got some tweets that are like, I hope you're joking with the title carried, which is what I titled the last episode, because you actually played quite well on that run, and you know what? I appreciate that a great deal. Thank you very much for your support. I'm trying to get good at Gungeon still. I saw a post on the subreddit that was like, I'm only on like episode 30 of Gungeon. Does NL ever start reading the Ammonomicon? The answer to that question, as you'll discover in 80 episodes or so, is occasionally, yeah. I mean, the Ammonomicon is not like the be-all end-all, but it does give you some useful information about what's going on. I don't think we really want to, you know, get bullet time. We don't have an active item, but bullet time means that if I ever get an active item again, I'll have wasted the money that we spent on bullet time, even though bullet time's not that bad, it's not that useful either. How did I not get hit there? So I'll be the first to admit that I have sort of fucked up this run right off the bat by taking damage so early. We're gonna be looking for an extra key wherever we can find it. But we really have no chance to flawless the first boss with just the Betrayer. So I think, unfortunately, my hands are somewhat tied. If we end up having to get a brown level gun, we have to get a brown level gun, you know? Having the crossbow to fight the first boss is definitely better than trying to kill it at melee range. Regardless of what boss it is, for that matter. But, you know, some are going to be easier than others. We could also just get a red heart. That's also reasonably plausible. But, who knows the reverberating impact of that damage that I took early on here, but to be honest with you, I feel good about my Gungeon play lately, even on runs that have gone fairly poorly. Those have become few and far between relative to runs where at least I think we've got a certain level of competence. You know, there's a big quantum leap that happens in a lot of roguelites, and I think it happens in Gungeon as well. Or at least I feel anecdotally like it's happening in Gungeon right now. And that's what happens when you stop losing because you suck at dodging, or shooting for that matter, and you start losing because you're making bad decisions. That's a necessary step on the road to competency, and I think we're getting there. I think most of the time that I lose, it's because I'm making bad decisions, or still, to an alarming degree, not flawlessing the bosses. Like taking little damage, but unfortunately that damage coming in the worst possible moments. We're gonna open whatever chest is better. They're both brown. What can brown do for us? That's a great question. We're going to find out in just a moment here, because we're going to probably open both of these. First one is ammo drop plus half a heart. That's actually really good. That means our other one is going to be a gun. And weirdly enough, we actually don't need a brown level gun now, because we're back at full HP. Now, of course, if we take damage on the boss fight, well, we have to take two hits, but if we take two hits on the boss fight, life's gonna get pretty tough for us, because we'll have to melee the boss to death, but hopefully we can ensure that that won't happen. We also got ammo synthesizer and some more HP. Ammo synthesizer, considering it comes in a brown chest, I'm gonna guess that it's not as good as it sounds. You know, play well, get ammo, but or a chance to get ammo on kills, but ammo has been a real concern for us, and you know, you don't need it to be always giving you ammo drops for it to be effective. As long as it just gives you ammo drops in a semi-timely fashion, that's pretty important. So we do have a room that could be fairy in a jar, could be map man here. I think we just start by fighting the boss. Could be fairy in a jar, could be map man. I would obviously rather it be map man. This is where I'd like to actually have a little bit more access to the numbers and be like, okay, what are the odds? Like, what pool does Mapman give us items out of? Is it just a random chance for, like, every item in the game? Are rarer items weighted accordingly, etc., etc.? I recognize I'm not handling this fight super efficiently. but I'm doing it in a way that I think gives me the best chance possible to survive. So I've still got almost all the HP left on this guy. We do have two blanks left as well, though, so just keep ourselves as far away as possible. I don't want to jinx myself, but I really do think that the Trigger Twins are the easiest first floor boss, and that pretty much cements that opinion right there. So we also get the Buzzsaw and some more armor, which is really nice. We have 102 credits. How the hell did that happen so quickly? And I almost feel like we should go down to the Oubliette. The Oubliette was good last time. So we can buy a key, go down to the Oubliette, and hopefully pick up some more items down there. Why not? Well, one reason why not is because it's going to take some time. But apart from that, why not? How do I feel about the Buzzsaw? I think it's like a worse version of Super Meat Gun, but that's still not bad, necessarily. So after that poor damage, everything's pretty much turned out according to plan here, I suppose. Unfortunately, this means we won't be able to go to Map Man or Fairy in a Jar Room, but it's a weighted decision, I think. I think it's relatively sensible to do things the way that we've chosen to do them here, and the Oubliette, for the most part, has served me well. I really like at least that we have a backup gun. A gun that we can use if we run out of HP, or if we stop having max HP, and I think that we're well on our way to having a second run that has a chance at victory, at least. Of course, you can never say if it's I left the Flawless behind, didn't I? Well, you know what Aaliyah said. If first you don't succeed, first you don't succeed. Dust yourself off and try again. Now, you might say, oh my god, you are an idiot. I can see the dislikes piling up already. I like the video, but you made a stupid mistake, so I'm gonna dislike it. No. You know what? It just motivates me more. Because now if I lose this run, I have to look inwards. And I'm not one for introspection. That's not true. I tend to be pretty introspective. But, If I lose this run, I have to go and say, well, maybe I would have won if I'd actually picked up that Flawless that I earned. So, I don't want to do that. I would rather just win in spite of myself. So let's, if nothing else, it motivates me even harder. I'll admit, bit of a sinking feeling in my stomach right now when I came down to this floor and was like, wait a minute, I have less HP than I thought I would. That's okay, let's just consider that the tax for playing the Bullet. A wonderful character! Not that I don't need all the help I can get, but... Alright. You know what? It's a mistake. Everybody makes mistakes. The important thing is how you react to said mistakes. Nobody's gonna go through their life mistake-free. Even stupid mistakes. All we can do is choose the way that we react to this mistake, and I'm gonna choose it as a moment to galvanize us on this run. And to make our life better, and hopefully, you know, give me more motivation to succeed. That's the thing, so many people out there, and this is not an unnoble pursuit, but they base their life and their perception as if, you know, it's possible to go through life never doing something that's stupid. It's not possible. At least if it's possible, I've never seen anybody do it. Certainly have never done it myself, as we've noticed from missing the Flawless right here. What's more important is actually, like, making mistakes. I know this is something people say, like, hey, making mistakes is how you learn. But you go, yeah, but I'd rather just be right all the time, right off the bat. I mean, that's true, of course. You know, it can be embarrassing to make mistakes. I'm a little embarrassed right now. I'm choosing to lean into that embarrassment and hopefully glean an important life lesson from it. And the life lesson is, let's not do that again. You know, what's our action plan? My action plan is let's be a little... Wow, that was idiotic. But let's, take a little bit more time and a little bit more care next time we fight a boss and, try to avoid doing this to ourselves and handicapping ourselves on the run for no reason. And we'll move on. You know, no sense beating yourself up over it. Instead, we're gonna treat it as a learning experience to improve maybe not just our Gungeon life, but our whole life in general, you know? Alright, that's enough self-help mumbo-jumbo for now. I feel like, honestly, considering that the Oubliette is a little bit more difficult than your average second floor, I feel like we played pretty well here in spite of the damage that I took. Really, like, although I said it was idiotic, What was idiotic was not the execution of how we took damage. It was the failure to plan, honestly. I forgot that the sword swing hits in like a, you know, maybe 130 or something degree arc in front of you. Just an approximation. And I was like, well, let's just swing, and maybe the hitbox will only be directly in front of us, and as a result of that, we have no danger posed to ourselves here. Now, this is another, like, failure to plan is a plan to fail sort of moment right here. There's no reason we should be standing in the shit. But I feel like with the bullet, there's, like, a quantum leap where you realize that the best way to attack is to attack as bullets come in, and then you get like a free hit, essentially, and you also destroy the enemy bullets. Like, there's very little risk to yourself in that. All right, 130 something credits. We will open a green chest, and it's decent, definitely. Space friend, nothing wrong with that. Ooh, and we do have our secret room, which is going to give us another chest and another blank. So at this point, if we can get another key, then that's probably one we'll want to open. Space friend is solid. It also, I think, Space Friend tries to jump in front of shots to block them, which is nice. Honestly, I don't think we have any need to use Gun Muncher. I mean, as of right now, we only have two guns. So not only do we have no need to use the Gun Muncher, I don't think we have the fuel required to use the Gun Muncher in the first place. So the big thing for this floor is keeping our HP at or above maximum. We're a little bit above maximum right now, but It's pretty important. Oh my god, we did it. It's pretty important just to ensure that, you know, I really think that relative to most characters in Gungeon, the bullet is very momentum based. The longer you can stay at full HP, the more advantages you're going to accrue over the course of an entire run. So I think that as long as we can keep our HP full as long as possible, that would be nice. And of course, if we can get something that enables that in the future, like Gun Knight, you know, Greaves, Gun Knight Armor, Gun Knight Helm, etc., etc., any of the Gun Knight pieces, then that's pretty sweet. I don't know what you use against this boss, but I sort of feel like the best course of action is just to continue using the Blasphemy. Not only because it's got good damage output, but also, of course, the added defense that we get. So far, so good on this. Ooh, I think Space Friend might have saved us from a bit of a tricky situation there. Yeah, I'm getting a little greedy on my shooting here. Remember, try to shoot as the bullets come in, and essentially you've given yourselves free shots. Anything you destroy here is only going to benefit you in the future. Keep in mind, there is the ability to reload the Blasphemy. And when you reload it, it destroys, like, all bullets in a certain range of you. I've got to... Well, it's not close enough. I've got to figure out how to use that with proper implementation, because for now, it's not really working out for me. That was a terrible dodge. I dodged in the direction the bullet was traveling, which is, like, a super terrible recipe, unless you're trying to cook up a side of disaster for yourself. Very close here. One more hit may actually do it. So I'll consider this a pretty good fight, but, you know, we got a little lucky with the fact that we didn't get burned really badly on our terrible dodges there. No flawless, of course, but we get the Crescent Crossbow. I actually have no idea what this is. I don't think I've ever seen this before. But, it seems high quality based on the fact that it comes in a, ammo quantity of only 100, which is fairly low for an item, for sure. So you can buy another key. For 30, I think we do. And I don't think we care about getting the Gun Knight Armor or whatever, the old crest. I did see some people in the comments that were like, do an old King run. I've talked about this with Austin a little bit. The Oubliette has the ability to give you some extra momentum, and it's not too hard. It's a little harder than where you'd normally face it in the game, but or than what you'd normally face in the game at this point, but the old King is just too much of an asshole. Okay, the blooper's good. Are we completely done with this floor? In which case, we won't be able to get anything from that blue chest, but that's fine. We actually have three blanks, so we will be able to bring one extra blank down to the next floor. But, yeah, I really feel like, you know, we could do the old king for zaniness, but it's kind of like doing the hush with no keys in Isaac, in case you're not familiar with Isaac. He's a very difficult, or relative to the rest of the game, at least a very difficult boss that gives you some rewards, but really it's something you do when your run is just popping off to begin with. Hopefully, we maybe find opportunities to do that in the future, but for now, I think, you know, Gungeon as is hard enough that I don't necessarily need to be rocking the boat with challenge runs just yet. But this run is actually going fine. Of course, I'm still disappointed that we very idiotically did not pick up the flawless that I earned for myself, but you know what? That's in the past. As Kanye West said, my presence is a present. Kiss my ass. Wait, that's a little rude. I didn't really mean it to come across like that. But I also didn't write it. That's Kanye. Kanye wrote that. I thought those guys died in one hit, but I appear to be mistaken. We definitely have to try out the crescent crossbow. I think the most logical place to use it is probably just... Well, you know what? Let's do it right now. Oh, it charges. Ah, we have seen this in Gun Game. And I think that largely I've been pretty impressed with it. Because of the fact that the shots... Oh, I didn't even see that. I should have seen it because it was on the screen, but my brain ignored it, I suppose. It seems like it makes more sense as a room clearer than as a boss killer because of the fact that the shots spread out, but we'll see. You know, I really feel like there's almost no reason to not use the blasphemy for now. But there's ample reason to not use the blasphemy in the future. And that ample reason is, you know, if we aren't at full HP. I have no sincere interest in the ammo drop as an item. So if we could get even a shitty active item, as long as it's better or at least more useful in, like, commonly than the ammo drop, then I'm happy. I mean... Not really gaining anything, especially considering we have the ammo synthesizer. Now, in the future, I may wish that I had that ammo drop back, but for now, sort of seems a little bit overkill for us. What is ridiculous right now, though, is our financial situation. I'm sincerely surprised that we have 171 credits here. I guess we did not really buy anything. We bought two keys. Yeah, we bought two keys. And we've done the oubliette. So maybe that plus, you know, one lucky 50 credit drop or something could do it. I don't know if the jar of poison is that effective either. It's the kind of thing where, like, it's probably effective, but I don't want to pay for it. Ah, okay. So these will give us levels of curse, but I think that the blood brooch is incredibly important, especially when we want to stay at full HP. And I think that the bracket key is a really good... spacebar item, or, you know, active item here, that we can use fairly prodigiously, but we will encounter jammed enemies now, but I think that trade-off is worth it. I'm leaving ammo behind, because at this point, I'm like, I'm not gonna shoot just to stop the rat from gaining some ammo, like, it seems a little petty. So I hope that each one of those items only came with one level of curse, which would mean that we're really just, the consequence of one level of curse is nothing, I think, and the consequence from two levels is... a slightly higher frequency of jammed enemies, which is not that bad. At least for what we got out of it. Oh, the extra armor is so helpful. As long as we don't get a jammed boss, at least. Now, we do have to be cautious, slightly, with our usage of the bracket key. Mostly because the bracket key takes a while to recharge. Alright, who we got on floor two? The holster, please. It is the ammo conda. I do still think that it's the right thing to do to use the blasphemy here. Wow! One use of the E key does not destroy the things that it eats to gain buffs. That's actually ridiculous to me. God damn you, Ammo Conda. Okay, a little dicey. Great news is we still have two blanks left. I guess if we can't see the ammo condo, we might as well... That was a little too close for comfort. We might as well fire at the things that buffs it. Okay, we're out of blanks now. Just go for it, dude. You got it. Oh, okay. Don't forget the flawless. And honestly, I believe that we pretty much hit our end of the bargain here. Thank God. We got a key as well and some extra armor to back us up. Good stuff. This is why you don't just stop the recording and completely capitulate after, you know, making a big mistake like getting a flawless behind. I think we started to rebuild this run. Well, it wasn't even that bad, but we started to build this run back out. And in a respectable fashion, you know? Everybody loves a nice comeback story. We're done with the Gungeon proper real quickly as well. So we'll open the blue chest. Gave us the witch pistol. I think it's pretty good. And then we'll head down to the next floor. We didn't really have anything we wanted to buy. I don't really care about picking up more junk at this point. And that's, you know, the first 20 minutes of this run, we built ourselves a pretty good foundation. We got one out of two flawlesses. Some good guns, I think at least. And those guns are just backup for when the blasphemy inevitably doesn't work for us. But let's remember, we also have Blood Brooch and Ammo Synthesizer. So we're going to be regenerating health occasionally, which is really important once we get down to bullet hell. And we're going to be... Okay, this is a little bit cheesy, but I'll take advantage of it nonetheless. Reminds me of, like, PAX Prime... PAX West, I guess. A few years ago, they were demoing Hotline Miami 2, but it was still like a pretty early version of it. And it had some bugs. You could actually like swing your sword through the wall in order to kill enemies. So, of course, that's what I did. I was having some trouble actually beating the level. And then we swung our sword through the wall. I defeated the level, and they said, hey, don't do that. And I said, I like your game a lot. And they were like, that's cool. But... still, you're highlighting this bug on the show floor in front of people. They were actually really cool about it. They seemed like they were aware of the fact that this has been happening. Just try that. Yeah, the story really makes me out to be more like a badass than I actually am. But I was like, maybe I should stop using this bug, but at the same time, it's a hard game. I know in the world of, hey, I can beat every Legend of Zelda in 10 minutes, it's not that hard, but... I'm not that kind of guy, you know? I'm still the kind of guy I'm dealing with, like, level 30 of Polybridge right now, wondering how the hell do I make a fucking suspension bridge that actually functions properly. Looking up, you know, Google image search, how does a suspension bridge work? Just gotta watch out for the bullets that actually persist. And I did lose a little armor, and I'm disappointed about that, you know, during my tangent. Might have gotten a little distracted there. That's on me. Life goes on, and actually we're doing quite well here. Financially, we're back in a good spot. Now, what do I value here, passives or guns? The problem with passives is that I have to remember that in Gungeon, we're actually lumping actives in with it. So I really don't want to get another active because that effectively means we picked up Curse for nothing, although when we drop the E key, or keep going to the E key. When we drop the bracket key, the curse might disappear. There's like a real... Oh my god, what broke it? Was that the spaceship? The space shit that broke that? I'm on to you, space shit. Lockpick. Sling's pretty good. We'll probably end up buying a... Oh, we'll probably end up buying a key. Two blanks. And more keys. We may not buy a key, actually. Will we buy the sling? I don't know. It's tempting, because it's a pretty good gun. I think we already have some pretty good guns, though. But I need to smarten up and not lose any more armor. That was a really lucky secret room find. Just go for the boss fight. You have the key ready. Oh my god, it's a jam treadnought! Okay, don't... I was just gonna say, don't panic. Turns out, perhaps panicking would have been a shrewd move. Damn it. Jammed bosses. That's alright. The Flawless is unattainable here. But I think fighting a jammed version of a boss is a pretty good excuse to not get a Flawless. You know what? We're getting ammo drops. Why don't we try using our crossbow here. See how it works. There are enemies here that I don't like, so having some ability to kill them is good news, I think. Really, at this point, it's about trying to keep our HP at full so we can use the blasphemy on the next floor. And then I think the situation is, like, actually totally fine. You might say the crossbow's not working out that well for us as a boss killer, and I would actually be inclined to agree. But I'm going to continue to use it just because it means that if we get one ammo drop, we can refill this entire gun. Whereas if we switch to another gun, we're going to need, you know, a second ammo drop. And honestly, I'm starting to feel a little bad. It seems like this should have been a fairly plausible Flawless. Jammed or not jammed. I've only been hit once. We don't really have any need for our blanks anymore, but I guess it is important to use them to stave off some damage. Again, I keep forgetting, full HP is actually extremely valuable for us. I don't know, the fact that we're killing the Treadnought with the crossbow like this, considering it's jammed, might be indicative of this actually being like a pretty okay boss killer, but it definitely seems like more of a room clearer to me. Sixth chamber unlocked. Why, though? Probably because we killed a jammed boss or something? So I think the plunger is great. We'll use that to augment the blasphemy a little bit, but we have to definitely watch out for the poison ourselves. I'm actually, despite the fact that we didn't get the Flawless there, I'm pretty pleased with that. Our HP being lower than we'd like it to be is, of course, suboptimal. But the Blood Brooch effectively means that we're pretty unlikely to find ourselves in a very common bullet hell situation, which is having, like, you know, 7 HP, but we can only ever keep, like, 4 of it full. We're much more likely to actually keep an effective level of HP, I guess. So we'll open it. Oh, it's a freaking mimic. Thank God we saved the E key. It's going to make this slightly easier. And by easier, I mean bracket-ier. Alien Engine is not usable, in my opinion, unless we have no other options, A, or B, get something that gives us some level of invincibility. And not just invincibility from contact damage. You know, because sure, you might say, hey, you're just getting, like, closer to the enemy, but you can't be hit by contact damage anyway. That was stupid. That is true, but we can still be hit by bullets, and the closer you are to an enemy, the harder it is to deal with those bullets. He doesn't take poison damage underground. We'll take the crossbow ammo. We have a fairy in a jar, which is actually great news in case we find ourselves not being at maximum HP by the end of this floor. Flying enemies basically give us no need to use the plunger, but and you might be saying, you know, you've seen runs where I've used the plunger and I've fucked it up. I think that's fair. There have been a lot of runs like that. Ooh, play well, get keys. Okay, so we probably never need to buy keys again. That's great news. I think you're right, but I still think, at least in theory, and we'll come to our own conclusions about practice, but at least in theory, it's the right decision to use the plunger as a little bit of an augmenter here. And you know what? Compared to the last run, this run is very simple. You know, last run, we did get the heroine early, so life was pretty good, but at the same time, we had to worry about, oh, we're gonna switch to this weapon for this fight. Really, at least for now, we're just using the plunger and the blasphemy, and life's easy. The problem is, I do have to play, I think, a little stronger than I played on the last run to achieve the same result. And of course, I did fuck it up myself and stupidly missed that earlier Flawless, which with the Blood Brooch would have been a sixth synergy, but it's okay. Life goes on. All we can do is, again, as mentioned, probably ad nauseum at this point, you know, handle our shit from this point onwards. Oh, you know, we gotta kill a Skelly. I was gonna say we already hit him with the bracket key, so I'm pretty sure he's close to death. These guys are no biggie. And we did get a chest. It is Shadow Bullets. Lovely. I don't know if this actually works with the projectiles from the Blasphemy, but it basically means that every gun we get in the future... I hate that those bullets don't get destroyed by the Blasphemy, by the way. Or at least they don't reliably get destroyed, or maybe I just misinterpreted it. But I think we do this, even though it's two keys, because we have Master of Unlocking. And I'd say that probably it is not worth it, but it also carries effectively no penalty if we get enough keys on this floor anyway. So I'm not going to beat myself up over that one. Not too much, at least. It's the first bullet run in a while. By the way, I think the bullet is probably the easiest character in the game to win as. I think... Even though I probably have a better track record with the convict somehow, the bullet has so many advantages starting, but I think this is the first bullet run, maybe ever, for me. Not in, you know, Gungeon's collected history, but for me, where I've been at full HP the whole run thus far, and we're already on the fourth floor, so that's, I mean, unlikely that we're going to stay that way without getting some reliable source of armor, but still, that's a big moment for me. You didn't die? It almost spawned the consumable before he died, it looked like. Hey, where's my Master of Unlocking coming through in the clutch for me? I thought it said play well, get keys. My name's Felicity Shagwell. Play well, get keys by name. Play very well, get keys by reputation. You know, Austin Powers 2, the spy who shagged me. Classic film. Classic Canadian film. Is it a Canadian film? I'm gonna say yes because the star is Canadian. I don't know if that's how that works, but we'll take what we can get. So we took what we could get. She looked at me with the big brown eyes and said, Shagwell my name. Baby Shag, very well by reputation. This is, I mean, that's, I'm pretty sure Ain't Seen Nothing Yet is by a Canadian band as well. Is BTO Canadian? Does BTO sing that song? They definitely do Taking Care of Business. Maybe it's the Guess Who do that? Who sings Ain't Seen Nothing Yet? Sorry, I thought you guys were Siri for a minute there. Sorry, I have Windows 10. I meant to say, I thought you guys were Cortana. Oh no! Well, now we're not at full HP. And basically, that's for me being a total idiot. Sticky Crossbow seems like a decent gun to use for a moment here. Basically, me being a complete idiot and just not paying attention led to me falling in there. Figured we can make this work. Just, oh, there you go. You know what? No harm, no foul. Again. I ask forgiveness for my own idiocy, but it goes on. Probably. I like when enemies spawn into the poison. Makes life quite easy. And I keep picking up plunger ammo, but it doesn't really seem like it's that necessary. Some enemy is dead in here. I mean, the plunger, I should say, is pretty ammo efficient in and of itself. Where is... Oh, they're all dead. Captain, your men are already dead. So at least cover half this map with bullshit. Okay, that was the smartest use of the bracket key I've had in quite some time. First I was like, oh, it's just these cute little guys. And then, nope. Lots of enemies who are actually shooting at me quite prodigiously. More ammunition. I would say the Flawless, and we're going to go for it right now. The Flawless is important here, but it's fair. Oh my god, it's another fucking jammed enemy. But the Wallmonger is on the easier side of things, and I really felt like we did that there. we sort of got fucked for it, but let's go blooper and blasphemy. Rest assured, I've recognized, by the way, we should have used the blasphemy to clear a greater path. But I actually thought the roll was going to be fine. I know that previously the bullet was bugged a little bit, so its roll animation was actually not quite at the level it needed to be to dodge through that attack when it was intended to be. But I can't just keep, you know, relying on them having not fixed that glitch. I could have easily just fucked up my roll there as well. And this is how we should have handled this from the start of this. I'm amazed at the frequency of jammed bosses, though. Like, is this just interesting luck? I'm not even saying bad luck, because it's nice to get some experience with it. At the same time, I do kind of wish that maybe it could have waited until a run in which I didn't forget to pick up the first floor flawless, because it's been slightly difficult to get the flawlesses here after this point. Just gotta keep relying on the blasphemy. You know what? The fight takes as long as it takes. I think we've done a pretty good job of making this work so far. Oh, that was... I probably should have been hit there. I spammed the right bumper out of panic and created a situation in which it was difficult for myself. Have to keep interrupting my my blooper reload. He's not supposed to be this close to the bottom. What happens now? He just fucking kills us? He just kills us? What? This has changed everything. I'm so sorry that the episode ended like this. I had no idea. We had such a good run, and it ended so outrageously. That is a sudden death. Thanks for watching. I hope you guys enjoyed it. If you did, click the like button. Helps out a great deal. Of course, subscribe if you want to see more in the future. For now, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time. I'll add that to the Encyclopedia Throica.